sharing for that. I'm really honored to have this opportunity. I'm just going to speak a few words here. Cambodia, I'm originally from Cambodia, and I just want to give you a little bit of perspective here. My mom and dad in 1969 in Cambodia at the time. Still a country not technically at war with anybody, but soon to be. Our house, courtesy of Google Maps, a mansion really, now occupied by 10 families, each to a room in the house. Phnom Penh was a beautiful city architecturally. The Little Prince was playing, where the actual Prince of Cambodia started it and directed it. But across the world, you had President Nixon pointing to Cambodia, and of course, he had a reason to point at Cambodia because he had the Nixon doctrine there, in which he said there are no American combat troops in Cambodia, there are no American combat advisors in Cambodia, there will be no American combat troops or advisors in Cambodia who will aid Cambodia. Cambodia is the Nixon doctrine in its purest form, November 1971. What it meant was that American B-52s would be dropping bombs on Cambodia, which would avoid having soldiers on the ground in the sense of actually doing the fighting. And of course, that was terrible for the country, 113,000 sites. It began actually secretly from mid-65. Those of you who know your history can't state 1970. That was a protest of the secret bombing of Cambodia. And up until, here the map shows, 73, more tons of bombs fell in Cambodia than combined tonnage of World War II Europe and Hiroshima and Nagasaki in terms of nuclear weapons. April 17, 1975, Cambodia falls, Phnom Penh specifically falls, and it's really to this ragtag army of rebels called the Khmer Rouge. They're Maoist-inspired. Young people, not so different from you, really, in terms of age, and they've evacuated 2 million, they've decided to evacuate 2 million from the capital city, which they want to do in 3 days, including my own family. So we are sent in this exodus from Phnom Penh, and it is the leaders of the Khmer Rouge here, Pol Pot on the leftmost side, in a train car there. Cambodia, I can't describe it, but I'll use the words of Michael Paternity. Once upon a time, there was a regime so evil that it created an anti-society where torture was currency and music, books, and love were abolished. I mean, of all days, Valentine's Day, right? This regime ruled for 4 years and murdered nearly 2 million of its citizens, a quarter of the population, and that's crazy. I mean, that's one out of four people, if you think about it. But from my own perspective, our own story begins really in terms of a late day in 1975, close to sunset. My mother has been sent to these basically slave work camps, fields, along with my dad, and they've just come back from harvesting rice, which they knew not what, how to do because they were city dwellers anyways. But the Khmer Rouge have called a meeting in which they are to come, the commune is to come together, and they've told everybody that Vietnam wants its citizens back. Vietnam had become communist by then. And so it was a friendly communist country that was saying, hey, we want our people back. And my mom spoke some Vietnamese, so she decided that she was going to try out this option. Because if you watch World War Z with Brad Pitt, to move is to live. And so she thought, you know, to move, to change places is at least a chance to survive. On the third day of our journey, which takes months in terms of actually, you know, getting on our way, my father, who'd been sick with dysentery and malnutrition, dies. But he didn't speak Vietnamese, so it was actually kind of a weird blessing in disguise in that, what would we have done when the time came to actually see if he was Vietnamese? So, at 2 Vietnam, this is where we can actually try to get to Vietnam, and that's using language as our passport. And my mom here with five kids manages to take one exam under the Khmer Rouge in which she fools them to believe that she is Vietnamese. And she's now going to take a second exam under the Vietnamese cadres, the communist cadres. And before the exam, she's told by a Vietnamese auntie, who's also going to take the exam, that the names mom has given to the kids, she's switched all our names to Vietnamese names, the boys were given girls' names, and the girls were given boys' names. So she had to change all of that, and then the Vietnamese auntie tutored her like a drill sergeant for 3 days to help her improve her Vietnamese, which she then successfully passes. And there I am with mom in Vietnam, safe and sound, at a cousin's wedding. But it's not the end of the story. We've got so much more here from this journey. I've got mom there, my uncle and aunt who were living in Vietnam, so they helped us get to Vietnam, and then me. We are in Vietnam, but France is actually the only place we can go to from Vietnam, because mom knew already that Vietnam is a communist country. It's slightly better than the Khmer, but it's not really much better. And France was the only place that still had diplomatic relations with Vietnam, with communist Vietnam. So how to get to France, really quite a miracle there. We had a cousin in France who was a starving student in Paris, and he couldn't help much because he didn't have any money, and his last name wasn't the same as ours. But he bumps into this Frenchman, chain-smoking Frenchman, who decides to help. And he decides that he's going to look up and try to do what he can, and he finds in a phone book a woman with the same last name as my mother's and convinces her to sign her name to documents saying that she's related to my mom. And so, as a result, we're able to then get our paperwork through. We get to France. Here I am with my sister. At one point, my sister and I lived with French families because it was just so difficult for refugee families to survive in France. As much as we think about the welfare state and so on in Europe, France was very much a place where, you know, they expected you to work. If you didn't work, something was wrong with you. So mom had to work, and it was hard for her. In 85, my aunt in the U.S., another aunt, because you see the pattern here, we've got family everywhere, she decides to come to the U.S. and says, you know, we've got to leave France. The France is not good for us. So this is the actual plane ticket from Pan Am that we used in October of 1985 to get to America. And we arrive, we live in Oakland, California. That's the actual house that I lived in with my mother and sister. Our Christmases were like this. Mom worked in sweatshops in Oakland's Chinatown doing garments. Food stamps were our bane, and really, I mean, all I can say is still, despite all that, I think too much is given, much is expected. And so, I think I'm taking a lot of time, so I'm just going to skip a few hundred slides here and get to, you know, the lessons, the things about mom who passed away in 2009, what, as a woman, she felt probably were the lessons from her life. One of the guiding lessons she gave to me was the idea that what goes around comes around. She was Buddhist, so she thought that, you know, karmic justice would eventually meet the fate of the people who had hurt our family. And so I think, you know, in that sense, maybe she thought they'd be reborn cockroaches if they didn't find justice in this lifetime. And maybe she was able to forget the fact that really there wasn't justice in her lifetime. I mean, she passed away before the tribunal took place, and even now the tribunal that's taking place in Cambodia has got 3 people convicted, cost $200 million, and all this for 1.7 million dead, including my father and a missing brother on top of that. But for a lot of Cambodians, I think every day of their lives, they have to believe in some sort of karmic justice, because that's really the only way that I would say they can cope with the fact that there hasn't been justice in their life, and there continues to be injustice in their lives. And so, so in that sense, that's really the idea. Here she is in a photo mosaic. She had 7 years of schooling, 5 languages, and she saved lives. And the Talmud says, if you save a life, you save the world. If mom were here, I think she'd be happy that I was able to, with her help, bring more lives. I mean, we have, between my siblings and I, lots of kids, so 22 lives so far. And, you know, she was able to have 6 months with my firstborn, Stephen, who is now 7 years old, and my daughter, Caitlin, here, Nathan, and the latest addition, and there's no more, really, we can't afford any more kids. that's it, really, you know, the family, and Chabnan is in our office up there. I don't think she's come down here to listen to me, but But you know, obviously, we're very, you know, we try to do what we can. In fact, even now, we've continued trying to help. So in the last few years, there were some winners of the green card lottery in Cambodia. We've been able to help sponsor them. Even if you win the green card lottery, you have to find a sponsor who's willing to take responsibility for you. So this couple here came to the US because we vouched for them. They had a child, so that's three now. And then last year, we helped this family of four who'd also won the green card lottery. And you know, I find my responsibility in continuing to give back as continuing to speak on refugees and human rights. And I do that on the board of Refugees International, trying to promote their work and trying to, and we'll have the president, if I can give that plug, of Refugees International here tomorrow. So anyhow, thank you.